everybody. So glad to see you guys. Won't we stand up and worship today? Full control. We thank you so much. It is in your name we pray, we receive you. Amen.
Good morning. You may be seated. Well, good morning. Welcome to Jersey. It is great to be with you, all of you here in person, as well as everyone joining us online. And we want to let you know that if you're new with us this morning, we'd love to get an opportunity to meet you, to find out a little bit more about you, how things are going in your world, and answer any questions you may have. So if you're here with us, feel free to head on out to the welcome area, and there'll be a gift out there waiting for you as well. If you're joining us for the first time online, just text the word new to 740-457-1525, and we will be in touch. Well, this morning, just three quick things to make note of. First, most of you probably saw this on the way in, but we're really looking forward to celebrating the Lord's Supper together as a church family. So if you didn't pick up the bread and juice, make sure and do that before we arrive at that opportunity later in this morning's service. Secondly, a few things to remind you of for this Christmas season, a lot to look forward to, and the most timely of which is our women's Christmas gathering that is coming up this Thursday, December 4th at 7 p.m. This is a staple, really an annual tradition here at Jersey where the women of all ages come together to enjoy a sweet time of fellowship. So if you've never been, if you're newer with us, or if you've been around Jersey for a while and have just never been able to come, just highly encourage you to do so. I know if you were to ask women that have been in times past, they would let you know that it's a time to be able to interact with a lot of different women, to potentially make some new acquaintances, as well as to catch up with people that you might not see on a regular basis. So you can register for that online at jerseychurch.org/events. You can do that today, or you can do it out at the welcome area as well. Then next Sunday night is our annual kids family experience for Christmas, and that is for moms and dads and grandparents and of course kids too, to come together in celebration of Christmas. And then the following Sunday night, that is December 11th, that'll be at 3 and 6, that'll be our Christmas in the chapel, our worship experience over in the chapel on the 11th. And finally this morning, we are kicking off a new series that will last throughout our Christmas season called Arrivals. And the theme verse for this series comes from Luke chapter 2, verse 11. Today in the city of David, a Savior has been born, who is the Messiah, the Lord. And you can tell that I still need some practice on this verse. And so we are going to practice this together and continuing to work at hiding God's word in our hearts. So let's go ahead and say this verse together. Today in the city of David, a Savior was born for you, who is the Messiah, the Lord, Luke 2:11. And may this be a reminder that the Lord brings back to us throughout the Christmas season for what we have in store for us as we anxiously await celebrating what God has done for us and sending his Son to redeem and rescue us. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, Lord, we thank you for this morning. We thank you for everything that we have to look forward to, both in our time together today, as well as in the weeks to come. And Lord, may you be glorified through this time of worship through song. And Lord, may you be further glorified as Brian comes and opens up the word for us today. And help us to really hone in on exactly what you would have us to take away and apply to our lives. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Scars.
you died. Father, we exalt you. We praise you. You are holy of our praise. You are worthy. We say it time and time again.
Thank you.
Father, you are faithful. Father, we know that you will come like you promised. We hold so many things in your capable hands. Father, we ask for a move today. Father, you know our hearts. Might you just search them out? Might you show up in a miraculous new way? Father, I'm fascinated with how you move. You're so beautiful. We ask that you show yourself, God. We know that you're here, but we say, show yourself. So good. It's because of your son we're here still standing. We say amen. Amen.
Amen. You all can have a seat. Thank you, band. That was amazing. Those songs are wonderful and, wow, just tie in so well to where we're kind of heading today. Well, first of all, let me just say happy Thanksgiving. Hopefully everybody's having a wonderful Thanksgiving weekend. It sure is good to see everybody. I know that if we were to stop and kind of think about all the different things we have to be thankful for, many, if not most, maybe even all of us could start listing things and it would fill up more than a page, probably multiple pages. And so we certainly have a lot to be thankful for individually, and we certainly have a lot to be thankful for as a church family. You know, last week, if you joined us, we kind of hit the pause button just briefly. We watched a video, and in that video, we were able to look back and celebrate much of what God has done in and through Jersey over the last year. And so, so much to be thankful for. It certainly left us feeling thankful. And so as we think about that, as we think about Thanksgiving weekend, on behalf of our entire staff, I just want to say that we are incredibly thankful for each and every one of you. And so happy, happy Thanksgiving. Well, as Todd mentioned earlier, we are kicking off a brand new series, a series we are calling Arrivals. You know, every year at Christmas time, we celebrate the arrival of Jesus on earth. And we are going to be focused on that throughout all of December, through our events that Todd mentioned, our women's gathering that's happening this Thursday, our Kids FX, our Christmas in the Chapel, and then, of course, our Christmas Eve services and Christmas Day service on Christmas morning. We will be focused on the arrival of Jesus. But as we think about this series, one of the things that we are going to talk about is God arriving throughout time in history. And each time that God arrived throughout time in history, we see that God would bring salvation to his people each and every step along the way. And while the arrival of Jesus was certainly the crescendo of that and God's plan to rescue us from sin and death, over these next 5 weeks, we are going to be able to discover that when God arrives, he does bring salvation each and every time. And so if we were to look at all the arrivals of God in Scripture, it would certainly be longer than a five-week series. So we've picked five, and we're going to look at those. And we're going to kick things off this morning as we journey back into the Old Testament. We're going to be in the book of Exodus. And we are going to pick up as the Israelites have just made their escape from slavery and bondage in Egypt. And so if you would, go ahead and find Exodus chapter 20. Exodus chapter 20 will be in verse 2. While you are looking for that, let me just go ahead and kind of set the scene for what is happening. Moses is on Mount Sinai. He's way up on Mount Sinai. The entire nation of Israel is in the valley below. Now, it's also a good idea to kind of explain the nation of Israel very quickly. The nation of Israel, now, the entire history of this people, I mean the whole history of the nation of Israel, all they have ever known is slavery and oppression. For 400 years, all they have known is slavery and oppression. You see, the nation of Israel began with a guy named Abraham. Many of us know this. Abraham had a son named Isaac, who had a son named Jacob. Jacob would go on to have a bunch of sons who would then go on to have families of their own. Well, this family would eventually move into Egypt. And as years would pass, the family would continue to grow. Leadership in Egypt would change. And as this family would continue growing, it was eventually moved into slavery
but it wasn't a nation at the time. It was just a really big family. And as that family continued to grow, it would eventually grow into the nation of Israel. And for 400 years, all this nation would know is slavery and oppression. J. Vernon McGee, if you're familiar with anything that he's done, he has just a wonderful way of simplifying things throughout Scripture. And I was just reading some different things, and I came across something that he wrote talking about this. He says this: when Israel entered Egypt, it was a family. When they made their exit from Egypt, it was a nation. And during their time in captivity, God had been very, very silent. And for 400 years, all the nation knew was slavery and oppression. So fast forward. The nation is now at the foot of Mount Sinai. They're in the valley. Moses is up on Mount Sinai. God is about ready to give Moses and the nation his law. And that's where we pick up Exodus chapter 20, verse 2. We'll call this the prelude to the Ten Commandments. Verse 2 says this: I am the Lord your God who... And Moses may, in that moment, he may have just called a quick time out and said, well, wait, whoa, 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 wait a minute, God. Did you say the Lord your God? Well, yes, Moses, I am the Lord your God. No, you mean you're the Lord the God. No, Moses, I am the Lord your God. Well, God, that kind of seems kind of personal, like we have a relationship happening. Yes, Moses, that's exactly what that means. No, you mean you're the Lord, the God of everything. Well, Moses, that is true. I am the God of everything, but I am also the Lord, your God. Well, God, I don't know if you've noticed this or not, but we're just a bunch of slaves. I mean, look at us. We don't know what we're doing. I mean, we're just kind of following along here trying to figure it out. You mean you're the Lord, the God. How are we your people? Well, Moses, you are mine. You belong to me. You are my people. I am your personal God. And so we see this playing out in Exodus chapter 20, verse 2, where he says, I am the Lord, your God, who brought you out of Egypt, out of the place of slavery. And you know, in that moment, you know, you hear words like this, and I'm sure Moses, as God is talking, Moses is probably reliving all of the things that had just taken place, all the different things that they had just walked through as a nation. Remembering for 400 years, all the nation knew was silence and slavery and oppression. And after 400 years, you know, I wonder if the nation of Israel started to really question things. I wonder if the nation of Israel started to look at the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob as more of a myth than a real God. And God would declare, I am the Lord your God. And Moses is on this trip down memory lane, and he's remembering where God would send him to Pharaoh. And God sends Moses to Pharaoh, and Moses is to declare to Pharaoh to let the nation of Israel go free. And so many of us know what happens. Moses goes to Pharaoh. Moses tells Pharaoh what God has told him to say, and Pharaoh says no. And Pharaoh would say no time and time and time again. He said no, he said no, he said no. And God would send plague after plague after plague into the land of Egypt. And for 400 years, remember, all they've known is silence and slavery and oppression. And now the nation of Israel has front row seats to these amazing, awesome, miraculous events. And they're starting to think to themselves, I have no idea what's going on, but someone has finally come to our rescue. After 400 years, someone has finally come to our rescue. Well, Moses goes back to Pharaoh one more time. After these amazing, awesome, miraculous events, Moses goes back to Pharaoh one more time, and he would declare to Pharaoh one more time to let the nation of Israel go. And right on cue, Pharaoh says no. And it was in this moment that God would begin talking to the nation of Israel for the very first time, Again, remember, 400 years, they haven't heard from God as a nation. And this is where God would speak to the nation of Israel for the very first time. If you're in Exodus, follow along, go back just a little bit. Exodus chapter 12. This is where we find God giving the nation of Israel his very first command. Again, 400 years, they've heard nothing. And this is what God says to the nation of Israel. Exodus chapter 12, verse 1. The Lord said to Moses and Aaron in the land of Egypt, "This month is to be the beginning of months for you. It is to be the first month of your year." And so right out of the gate, this is so cool because we see God arriving right in the middle of what is happening. God arrives and he already begins making things new. Verse 3. Tell the whole community of Israel that on the 10th day of the month, they must select an animal of the flock according to their father's families, one animal per family. If the household is too small for a whole animal, that person and the neighbor nearest the house are to select one based on the combined number of people. You should apportion the animal according to what each will eat. Verse 5. You must have an unblemished animal, a year-old male. You may take it from either the sheep or the goats. Now, this is a foreshadowing of what is to come. This is a foreshadowing of Jesus, and we will eventually get there in our arrival series. But this is a foreshadowing of Jesus who would eventually arrive in sinless perfection as our sacrificial lamb. But what is happening here? What is going on right here? Remember, the nation has never heard from God before. When they finally hear from God, he gives them instructions on having dinner. Verse 6, you are to keep it until the 14th day of this month. Then the whole assembly of the community of Israel will slaughter the animals at twilight. And so you can kind of gain a sense in this verse 6 right here, what is happening. You've got this large group of people, and that's really an understatement because when you think about just how many made up this nation of Israel, I mean, if you study it, you'll see different numbers, but you'll see numbers 1 million, even up to 2 million people. So when you think about the number of households that would be, the number is countless. When you think about the number of sacrifices that would be, the number is countless. And so as we think about what is happening in this moment, I wonder, in this moment, as countless households are making countless sacrifices, I wonder if God didn't see this as one sacrifice, as the whole assembly of Israel came together and sacrificed at twilight. And although the nation is probably still a little confused, 400 years of silence and then instructions on how to have dinner, at least they were used to slaughtering animals. At least they had that much going for them. But this is where things are going to start to get a little strange. Verse 7, they must take some of the blood and put it on the two doorposts and the lintel of the houses where they eat them. And let's just go ahead and jump down to verse 12. I will pass through the land of Egypt on that night and strike every firstborn male in the land of Egypt, both people and animals. I am the Lord. I will execute judgments against all the gods of Egypt. The blood on the houses where you are staying will be a distinguishing mark for you. And if you wonder why they call it the Passover, here it is. When I see the blood, I will pass over you. No plague will be among you to destroy you when I strike the land of Egypt. Now, although the nation has had front row seats to what has just taken place with all these plagues, and God finally decides to speak to the nation of Israel, this is still going to require a lot of faith and a lot of trust on the part of the nation of Israel. I mean, remember, 400 years, nothing. Then all this starts happening in front of them. They're probably still trying to figure out what in the world is going on. And then God tells them to do this. And so this was going to require a good amount of faith and a good amount of trust on the part of the nation of Israel. But who was saved that night? Those that were saved that night were those that had put their faith and their trust in what God had asked them to do. Verse 14, this day is to be a memorial for you, and you must celebrate it as a festival to the Lord. You are to celebrate it throughout your generations as a permanent statute. Here's what God is saying to the nation, and this is so important. Remember, through all these instructions on what they're to do, with the blood on the doorpost, this is what God is saying to the nation of Israel. He's saying, listen, I'm not just showing up right now and telling you what to do. I'm not just here to be your lawgiver. I want to be your rescuer. I want to be your savior. I want to land. I want to arrive right in the middle of your greatest need, and I want to be your deliverer. But all I need you to do, all I need you to do is trust me. Because listen, I know that the whole blood thing on the doorpost, that's gonna feel so strange, that's gonna feel so weird. I know you're not gonna understand it, but I just want you to do this one strange, unusual thing as evidence of your confidence and your trust in me. I want to be your personal God. I want you to trust me. I want you to trust me. And then we find ourselves going back to where we started this morning. The nation of Israel is at the foot of Mount Sinai. Moses is up on Mount Sinai. God is about ready to give Moses and the nation his law. And God would say, Exodus chapter 20, verse 2, God would say, listen, because you trust me, we have a relationship. And because we have a relationship, I am here to say, I am the Lord, your God. And you know, I know that when we talk about having a personal relationship, I know many times, especially as you hear what we've just kind of walked through, and that kind of personal relationship that God was after, some of you would just say, Brian, listen, I would love to have that kind of relationship. But look at my life. I mean, my life is an absolute mess. I've got good news for you. You don't have to look at your life like that anymore. God accepted an entire nation of slaves. God accepted an entire nation of slaves. In fact, if you were to go on and continue reading further in, you would find a couple of things out about this people. Actually, you would discover a whole lot more than a couple of things, but you would discover these two things for sure. Number one, you would discover that they were an unbelievably difficult people. Unbelievably difficult. In fact, there are passages that you'll read and you'll read it and you'll have to read it again because you're thinking to yourself, no, that can't be right. Nobody's gonna do that. And so you read it again and you find, I had it the first time. They are unbelievably difficult. In fact, you would begin to ask yourself, you know, you would have to really go out of your way to be as difficult as they were being. And so you would discover what an unbelievably difficult people the Israelites were. And then number two, you would discover that we have a whole lot more in common with them than any of us would care to admit. But yet we would find God saying, I am the Lord, your God. And in the same way, when Jesus Christ died on the cross, he died for all your sins, the entire mess. The entire mess. Hebrews chapter 7, verse 26 and 27 says this. For this is the kind of high priest we need, holy, innocent, undefiled, separated from sinners, and exalted above the heavens. We sang about that in our first song this morning, exalted above the heavens. He doesn't need to offer sacrifices every day as the high priests do, first for their own sins, then for those of the people. He did this, talking about Jesus, he did this once for all time, when he offered himself. And he is saying to you right now, listen, I want to be your personal savior. I want to be your rescuer. Just think about our verse, Luke 2, verse 11, that Todd walked us through this morning. Just think about that verse. What does it say? What does that verse tell us? Does it say that today in the city of David, a life coach was born for you? Does it say that today in the city of David, a mentor or a trainer or a teacher was born for you? And is there anything wrong with any of those things? Absolutely not. Those are all great things. Beneficial things, but that's not what we needed. We were in a mess. We were in a mess that we were never going to get out of, ever. There is nothing that we could do to save ourselves, but we needed saved. And the only way that was going to happen is by God looking down and saying, I'm going to have to send a savior. And so we read in Luke 2, 11, today in the city of David, a savior was born for you. What is he saying? He's saying this, listen, I want to be your rescuer. I want to be your savior. I want to arrive in the middle of your greatest need, and I want to be your deliverer. I just need you to do what the nation of Israel did. I just need you to trust me. And as we think about that trust, as we think about the trust that we have put in our Heavenly Father, as we think about the trust that we have put in Christ's work on the cross on our behalf, we're gonna move into a time now where we're gonna move into a time where we can observe the Lord's Supper, remember and reflect on what Jesus did for us on the cross. And so I'm gonna do two things. One, I'm gonna ask the band to come back out. And two, I'm gonna ask you to go ahead and get your cups ready because we all know how much noise this is about to make. So why not do it all together, right? So just go ahead and get your cups ready as we get ready to move into a time of the Lord's Supper. As the band comes out, they're gonna just play this morning and they're gonna close us in a song here in just a couple of minutes. And I do want to mention this, when it comes to the Lord's Supper, this is a time that is reserved for those that have put their faith and have put their trust in what Jesus Christ has done for them on the cross. And so if you're here this morning and you've never come to the point in your life where you've done that, where you've accepted what Jesus has done for you, we would just ask that you not take the bread and the juice in a couple of minutes as we do that together. But I would also say to you this, that as the band closes us in a song we're gonna sing here in just a couple of minutes, we're gonna give you an opportunity to learn more about what it means to have a personal relationship. And if you wanna know more about what that means, we're gonna have somebody right up here at the very end of our service. They would love nothing more than to help you understand what it means to have the personal relationship that we just finished talking about this morning. But as we get ready to move into this time, you know what's so cool about this time is the fact that 1,400 years or so after the Israelites experienced that very first Passover that we just talked about, 1,400 years or so later, Jesus is sitting in an upper room with his 12 disciples. And you know what they're doing? They're remembering what happened. Because remember, in Egypt, God said, listen, you only have to go through this blood thing one time. Now listen, I don't want you to ever forget it. I want you to remember it. And so 1,400 years later, Jesus is sitting there with his guys and they're remembering it together. So as we move into this time where we remember what took place with Jesus on the cross that night after he left that upper room, all those things that were to happen, where he would eventually go to a cross to die for your sins and my sins. As we sit and remember and reflect on that, this is a time of worship for us. And it's moments like this, it's moments of worship like this. And again, whether that's singing or praying or opening God's word or maybe giving back to him or serving or this right here in this moment, where we can reflect and remember what Jesus did for us. In moments of worship like this, it always comes down to a heart issue. Every single time, it comes down to a heart issue. And it comes down to us asking and answering the question, do you love God? Do you trust God with your whole heart today? Do you trust God with your whole heart today? You see, what we're gonna do here is a physical act. It's representing something. It's a physical act. It's expressing outwardly what God has done and continues to do in here. And that's what's about to take place this morning. You know, one of the central prayers in the life of Jesus goes like this. It's called the Shema. I'm not going to read the whole thing, but just a portion of it. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your might. You talk about trust. This verse tells us that we are to trust God with everything that we have, everything that we have. And so in this moment right here, I'm gonna encourage you to let everything else go. Just let it go. Whatever it is, whatever you walked in with, just let it go. In this moment, as we reflect and remember God arriving in the middle of Israel's greatest need, we can reflect and remember and celebrate that he arrived in the middle of ours as well. And so as we get ready to take the bread and take the juice in this moment, let's do just that. Let's spend this moment remembering God's arrival in our life. And let's spend this moment reflecting and celebrating what Jesus did for us on the cross. And as we do that, I'm just gonna encourage you with a verse that we all know. For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only son, that whoever would believe in him would not perish but have eternal life. Let's spend just this next moment reflecting on that, and then we'll take the bread and the juice together. Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, he took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me." I tell you what, let's go ahead and stand together this morning. We're going to pray. And then the band is going to close us in one last song. And again, if you're here this morning and you would say, "Brian, I sure would love to know a little bit more about what it means to have a relationship," you can do that. Luke is up here. Luke would love nothing more than to be able to help you understand that a little bit more this morning. And so as the band gets ready to sing, as they begin to lead us, you can just step out from where you are. Just make your way up here to talk to Luke. But as we sing this song, "In Christ Alone," there is a portion of this song that just captures me every time I hear it. And a portion of this song, and it's just a portion, it's towards the end of the song, and the lyric says this: "And as he stands in victory, sin's curse has lost its grip on me. And then I absolutely love this part, and it's just a complete reminder of the verse we just read out of Exodus chapter 20, verse 2. For I am the Lord your God. It says this, for I am his and he is mine, bought with the precious blood of Christ. Heavenly Father, we just want to say thank you today. Thank you for arriving throughout history to bring salvation to your people. And Father, thank you for arriving in our lives today. We just want to say thank you for Jesus. Thank you for your amazing grace and your amazing love for us. It's in the precious name of Jesus we pray.
Thank you.
Thank you for all that you have given us, all that you have shown us. We are amazed that we are here in the presence of a mighty work of your Son. We are humbled. We are forgiven. You have called us redeemed. We thank you for all of that. It is in your name we pray. We lift you up. Amen. You guys have a wonderful Sunday.